At first you'll say, well, holy cow, my plumber bill doubled. Well, of course it did, because they have to run all of this, but now you don't have an HVAC bill. That may be $15,000 to $25,000 less on the bill.
We're back. There have been some changes, as you can see. If you haven't seen the last video, check it out. I'll link it below. What are those big changes?
Yeah, we have a house now. It's not complete. All of the in-floor radiant heat's covered up. It ended up being 7 zones mm-hmm. to do the entire house. Ironically, it's just the way the plumbing worked, but zone 7 is an office area. Zone 6 is the garage, and then zones 5 and down are bedrooms and main living spaces. The beautiful thing about zones is they're not sequential, because what we'll do is zone 6 being the garage, I don't need the garage to be 70 degrees all winter. I mean, yeah. My cars would love it, but they don't get a vote. So so we'll just stick with, probably set that to 55. So when we got into the heat pump sizing, we went to the company who's going to do the geothermal drilling. They gave their opinion of what they wanted. We went to an industry expert on heat exchangers and heat pumps. He gave us his opinion on it. I asked you for your insights into the calculations. And then, of course, I always have my own opinion. It's, as they say, I write the check, so I'm going to have to, I get a vote. So the way it turned out was kind of interesting is one person said, just do a single stage heat pump. A single stage heat pump, it's just on or off. It'd be simple, it'd be easy, and away we go. And so that sounds good in theory, but then when you do a little more homework on the single stage, most single stages, they're bigger, but they're more made for commercial. So what you're really getting is a commercial heat pump that's downsized for a house. But commercial products, typically, the good news is they're usually very stout. The bad news is they don't care about sound insulation, they don't care about size as much, and those kinds of convenient things you would have in your home, because it's a commercial. Most commercials have mechanical rooms and they can put those things in it. Then the next one, which made a little more sense to me, which is a dual stage. So it's almost like you're driving. If the light turns green, you either have your foot to the floor, or you have your foot halfway off the accelerator. Either way, that's your two options. It's either full on or half on. But the nice thing about that is you're probably not gonna be full on very much. You're probably gonna be half on, because it'll be full on for a few days till the house gets warmed up. And then it'll be half on, if it's on at all, when it just needs to maintain some areas. And that's probably the way we'll go. And then the third option is called variable speed, which means it just speeds up, slows down, just like a normal car would driving. Speeds up, slows down, very efficient, because it's exactly what it needs at the time it needs it, and those kinds of things. The problem is, as you keep doing these, the pumps get smaller and smaller, so the BTU capability gets less and less, and then you turn into this, well, now on the variable speed, I need 2. So they're more expensive per capability, and now I need 2 of them. So yes, it's more efficient, but now my ROI is further down the road.
Yeah.
To get it.
Yeah.
So, that's why I said we'll probably end up with the 2-stage.
Yeah.
Because okay. Just mathematically, it's less upfront cost and will go and give us the ROI a little better.
Yeah. I've got one video where it says the advantages and disadvantages of the variable and fixed speed. What shapes the decision a lot is the insulation, and you have very good insulation.
Yes. Yes. So insulation wise, we will be the first thing we're going to do once we get all the windows and electric inspections and such done, they're going to spray everything. So they'll spray it, seal it, get that done. Then they'll put in the batting, and the batting, of course, they can just keep filling that in. And the one thing I learned a little bit, because I'd always seen the spray in insulation, and that's great, but I guess over time it settles. And then as it settles, you can kind of see where these cross members are through here. It will leave little gaps because it's settled. Whereas the batting is firm and in place, it doesn't move at all. So 30 years from now, the insulation's in the same place you put it. So we're going to end up going that route. It's a little more manual labor to do, but we plan on staying here. So we need to make sure it stays warm for the next 30 years.
Absolutely. That's great. Can you show us some of the piping?
Yeah. You've got the office, the master bedroom, master bathroom, media room, the guest bedroom. This is the living room, and then the garage. These are two by far the largest zones.
Okay.
The garage, obviously. The two biggest zones are the first two pumps it touches.
Yeah.
So as it goes down, the zones get smaller and smaller. And if you recall in our last time you had come to visit, the geothermal wells. This is the input output to those here. And then co-located over here will be the heat pump hot water heater. So the leftover, if you will, the leftover heat from the heat exchanger, the heat pump will come around and go to the hot water heater and fill it. And mathematically, that showed that that water would be 90 to 100 degrees Fahrenheit as it enters the hot water heater. So really, the hot water heater's only got to warm it up probably about 10, 15 degrees.
Okay.
And to maintain that. That's so much easier than the water coming in out of the ground that's probably going to be about 45, 50 degrees that has to get warmed up. So that should make that quite a bit more efficient. And I would assume that means that our hot water heater should last years and years because it doesn't have to work very hard. The heat pumps, they're not actually, I know we say they're big, they're actually not that large. And, you know, even the hot water heater, because there's the, you've probably seen the different heat pump hot water heaters, you can get them 8 feet tall and you can get ones that are short and fat type idea to fit however you want. We're going with the A.O. Smith. So it's a little taller. It'd be 80 gallons taller, not as wide. So it'll sit here nicely. We could almost put some shelving in and make this a bit of a storage room because there should be quite a bit of space left over.
Yeah.
It should be kind of nice. This looks like a hot mess when you look at all of the plumbing and piping for the in-floor radiant heat, all the hot water pipes that are going, the PEX that's going to all the bathrooms and the kitchen and those kinds of things. But that's where... that's the one difference here is when you put something like this in, instead of having an HVAC person that's going to be running all sorts of ventilation throughout the house, you're going to spend more money on a plumber, less obviously on HVAC. So you have to do some of those trades because at first you'll say, well, holy cow, my plumber bill doubled. Well, of course it did because they have to run all of this, but now you don't have an HVAC bill. And so that may be $15,000 to $25,000 less on the build just because you're not doing it.
Yeah.
So the one thing obviously with the plumber though, lots of planning because now that we have a foundation and in-floor radiant heat and all that, we can't change it. So if we decided we wanted to move where the bathroom was going to be or move some things around in the house, we're probably stuck. it's not happening. And so that's the other nice thing, just because I'm a low maintenance kind of guy, everything is easy to see, easy to get to, easy to find. There's different valving that we can do to turn things on and off if there's an issue. All of the controllers for the switching of the relays and the valving, everything's easy to see and get to. So truly, if we thought there was an issue, first, you could go to the thermostat. So we have thermostats. Each zone has its own thermostat. So there'll be thermostats throughout the house. If you thought you were having an issue, go to the thermostat. That didn't solve what you thought was going on. You could easily come in here and see all of the zones and the relays and see if maybe there's an issue with the pump or an issue with the relay. Because after that, there isn't much to go wrong with the system. And so it's kind of handy in that regard that, you know, it should be a low maintenance system, 25, 30, 50 years to where maybe a pump goes out, but you don't lose heat for the whole house. You're going to lose heat. In this case, maybe it's the garage or something. You could survive until the maintenance person can come out in a few days.
Yeah. Yeah. That's really great.
Yeah.
So overall, what do you think? Are you happy with your decisions? Is there something already where you're like, I would have done this differently?
I'm not sure differently yet, just because you probably won't know that till we move in and we live here a little.
Yeah.
The one big one is just understanding the heat pump better, because that's the one controversy, it seems, between the different engineers, you know, between HVAC, electrical, the plumber, the person who's going to be doing the geothermal wells. They all have a different opinion. What's the best solution for that? And I don't want to make it sound as if a heat pump's inconsequential in cost, because there's still thousands of dollars, but they're not tens of thousands.
Yeah.
So if we make a mistake there, I think we can live with that mistake, if you will. You settle in, and once you've settled in, this is just the way it works, and you think nothing of it again.
Yeah.
So like I said, you know, we may wish we had done the variable instead of the single stage or whatever we end up doing, but I think that will be the only piece otherwise. It will be interesting though for the cooling, because We've all gotten used to HVAC, you know, and having an air conditioner kick on, push cold air through the house, those kinds of things. We only have ceiling fans to move the air, and then we have a recovery unit at the master bedroom side that will go and exchange the air in the house every 30 minutes. But other than that, there's no air movement. And so the cooling, the way it works is the floors are going to suck the heat out of the house.
Mm.
And that's a different concept. What I was told, though, the warning on that is don't, because you'll have guests that'll come visit and they're like, oh, it's hot in here. And they'll go and turn it down to 64, 65. Because they think, well, that'll cool it quickly.
Yeah.
It won't. But the next day when they wake up and they step on the floor, it will be like walking on ice cubes.
Oh, wow.
And that will wake you up first thing in the morning.
Well, good to have that.
And with the recovery unit, I mean, its whole purpose in life is to put fresh air in the house without changing the temperature. You know, if it's 20 degrees outside, that fresh air, it's supposed to help slowly introduce it to the house. Mm. So you're not introducing a bunch of 20 degree air like you left the window open.
Yeah.
That kind of thing. I actually want to do a little more homework on that to kind of understand better how it works. It looks like an octopus vents kind of thing up in the ceiling. We'll figure out how that's going to go.
Interesting.
Dennis and I spent 1.5 hours recording this, and I condensed it to the 10 minutes that I thought were most valuable for you. If you enjoyed it, please hit the like button and let me know in the comments below if you have any questions. Have a great time and see you in the next one. Bye.